I've traveled every road in this here land. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man.
Thank you. First, I should note that while we've got four candidates here tonight, six are invited. The Republican convention's nominee for Senator Linda McMahon, and the Democratic candidate, Attorney General Richard Blumenthal, declined to participate. The Attorney General was washing his hair tonight, and Mrs. McMahon was trying to find out with her camera crew where he was washing his hair. We aim to finish at 8:30. Candidates will have 2 minutes each now for opening statements and closing statements. In between, we should have about an hour for questions that I've compiled from the suggestions by our participating groups and from my own review of the current issues. Candidates will be given 1 minute for answers to the questions. My daughter Stephanie is sitting in the front row with a stopwatch and signs to warn the candidates as their time runs down. If one candidate directly criticizes another, the moderator will have the discretion to give the criticized candidate as much as a minute to respond. But I think the candidates have realized that they're going to have as much time as they want to criticize McMahon and Blumenthal tonight. Open statement, 2 minutes, please.
I want to thank Susan and the FCTO for their advocacy on behalf of Connecticut's taxpayers. And I thank the candidates who have shown up tonight to explain to the audience and to those listening to the debate in their homes for sharing their views. As was mentioned, two candidates are missing, and I find it very disappointing that the Republican convention endorsed candidate Linda McMahon and the Democrat convention endorsed candidate Richard Blumenthal chose not to be here tonight. Engaging in these types of debates and discussions of issues that affect the people of the state of Connecticut and this nation are part of the political process, and that process should be respected by all candidates. I'm Rob Simmons. I am running for the United States Senate because I love my country, and I don't like where it's going. I don't like the bailouts. I don't like the unemployment. I don't like the rising deficits. I don't like the foreclosures, and in particular, I don't like the unsustained spending that threatens to bankrupt the country and saddle our children and the next generation of young people in the audience with debts that they just will never be able to pay. And I really don't like that the Democrat Party is going to come to us later this year or next year and ask for taxes to pay these bills. During my public life, I've always stood up for the taxpayer. When I ran for the Connecticut General Assembly in 1991, my first vote was against the income tax. In Congress, I supported the Bush tax cuts. I also supported eliminating the alternative minimum tax. I supported getting rid of the death tax, a tax that kills small business and kills our entrepreneurs and our farmers. I oppose higher taxes because they take away our freedom. And freedom and free enterprise are what made this country great. Thank you for your attention. I look forward to your questions.
It's going to cut through our time. First question, we'll start with Rob Simmons. What, if anything, has been done right lately in regard to strengthening the national economy? What has been done wrong, and what would you do in 1 minute?
Well, it's much easier to talk about what's been done wrong rather than what's been done right. I think virtually everything that has been done is not correct. The TARP bill that was passed in 2008 bailed out businesses that are too big to fail. As far as I'm concerned, there's no business in America that's too big to fail. I would prefer to look at small businesses, which apparently, according to the federal government, are too small to save. It's small business where the jobs are created. 70% of all new jobs created by small business. So let's go from the TARP to the stimulus. What did they get under the stimulus package? Any small business men or women in the group here tonight? What'd you get under the stimulus package? Nothing. And I've asked that question for the last year and a half. Nothing. So first of all, the TARP was poorly constructed and poorly framed, and I don't think worked very successfully. Second, the stimulus package did not work well. Thirdly, we've just had the financial regulatory reform. What is incorporated in the financial regulatory reform? What's incorporated in there is a $20 billion trust fund set up for another businesses too big to fail. I don't think they get it in Washington, D.C. I hope they can hear us here tonight.
It's federal spending. We're more, we're less.
First of all, across the board, you need spending cuts across the board. And I think you can work on percentages that then the bureaucracies can absorb. That's been done in previous times. That should be done now. We have altogether too many federal government employees, and they're making altogether too much money, often twice what they make in the private sector. And yet they're providing us with a product that we don't want. In the private sector, if a company is producing a product that people don't want, you don't raise the price of the product. In fact, the product won't be sold. And so the product that's being sold to us by the federal government is not something we want to buy, and it's too expensive. Point two, I'm a military guy, 37 years in the U.S. Army. But I feel that what we're doing in Afghanistan needs a close look. It's $100 billion a year. I believe special operations forces are much better suited to the type of conflict that we have there than a surge of 30, 40, or 50,000 new troops. I take a close look at that. And then finally, social welfare spending, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, very close look. And by the way, my mother, who paid into Social Security for 4 years, has been on it for 30. That really doesn't make economic sense. We've got to look at the criteria for eligibility.
Federal tax policy. Where would you tax more or less?
In medicine, you say, at first, do no harm. And harm is coming our way in December, in my opinion, with the expiration of the 2001-2003 tax cuts. If these are allowed to expire, Americans, middle-class Americans, working Americans, and small businessmen and women are going to be hit with the largest tax cut, I think, in their memory. Why is this? This is because there's a lot of talk now about increasing or allowing those taxes to expire on those making over $200,000 a year. And yet 40% of small businessmen and women in America today, which is where the jobs are created, file under subchapter S. So they will fall right into that problem area. I also really object to death taxes. Death taxes take away the family farm. They take away the family business. You pay money. You pay taxes on the money when you earn it. You pay on the interest or dividends when you save it. When you die, you pay a third time on that same dollar. I think it's immoral. And I think it undermines the economy that's based on small business and family-owned businesses.
Rob Simmons, Afghanistan and Iraq, would you vote for appropriations?
I spent 37 years in the U.S. Army, starting as a private, retired as a colonel, upwards of 4 years in Vietnam service with the Army and the Central Intelligence Agency doing counter-guerrilla operations. So I love the men and women that are serving us in uniform. I love their families, and I don't want to do anything to hurt them. That being said, I believe our troops have accomplished a task in Iraq. They are systematically drawing down, and that's good, and I think the lower profile that we have there, the better. As for Afghanistan, in spite of all of their best efforts, I believe this surge is counterproductive, that country is very different from Iraq, has a very different history and culture. It's a decentralized type of country with 2,000 years of fighting with tribal leaders and warlords in remote areas. The best way to deal with a situation like that is to deny the Taliban re-entry to sponsor al-Qaeda is special operations. Special operations that are run with the local government and with the warlords. I've promoted this for 2 years. I weep to think of what our troops are trying to do there with the rules of engagement that put them in harm's way and, in fact, have encouraged the Taliban to be stronger today than they were 3 years ago.